of time introducing most of these people, but I do want to say a brief word of introduction for Christy Goldfuss. She is the Managing Director of the U.S. Council on Environmental Quality. Now, what is that? That has been around since 1969, actually, and it was part of an era in which the United States of America actually decided that it was important for us to concentrate on the health of our environment because it supports the health of our people. That is very thematically appropriate for the topic today at Glacier. Climate change affects the health of our people and the health of our communities. And that's what we're going to focus on in this panel. The idea of adaptation and resilience, better understanding what the communities in the Arctic are experiencing, and how that experience is changing economics, social, cultural, and environmental things that are very, very important to not only those of us who live in Alaska, but those of us who live throughout the Arctic. So I would like to ask Christy to come say a few opening words about this topic and also how important it is to the United States of America. Please help me welcome Christy Goldfuss.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much, Fran, for those kind words and for having me here today. Thank you, everyone, for choosing this session and coming to hear a little bit about the administration's work on resilience in the climate change space. CEQ, as introduced by Fran, is part of the White House, and we're one of the 11 components that help advise the president, and we focus specifically on the environmental challenges. And as we heard this morning, there's clearly no larger challenge that we're facing right now than climate change. Much of Alaska is experiencing accelerated rates of erosion caused by a combination of repeated extreme weather events, thawing permafrost, and decreased Arctic sea ice. Alaska Native communities, many in coastal villages, as you know, are truly on the front lines of climate change challenges. Exacerbating environmental threats, limited job opportunities, and high cost of living make remote communities highly vulnerable to climate change impacts. These impacts are already forcing Native communities to alter their traditional hunting and fishing practices and rethink their cultural connection to land and sea, and socioeconomic inequalities are magnifying these impacts. We have a strategy that we're trying to implement across the federal government that focuses on three pillars. Some of these panelists are already familiar with them, but first, we focus on working with local leadership. And here in Anchorage, we have a strong mayor in Mayor Berkowitz. We also have worked closely with Mayor Joule as part of the administration's state, local, tribal leaders task force. The second pillar is IDing places or identifying communities that are at the highest risk and high risk and the least opportunity to address these challenges on their own. And the third area is responding with investments of federal dollars that have multiple benefits. So when we work together and when we use federal dollars, how are we making sure that those investments have a payback both in times that are solid and when we're facing crisis? I learned a little bit about how Alaska has been leading on this front a while back in 2013 when Julie Kitka and the Alaska Federation of Natives invited me here to Alaska to talk about the Arctic. I got an opportunity to go out to Tuntituliak and see what the village there had done. At that time, the price of diesel, as many of you may remember, was extremely high. So on their own, in coordination with Dennis Miner, who some of you may know, they built an incredible system that responded to the needs of the community and the challenges that they were facing and saved money. So what I saw there were five turbines that had just come online, a smart grid system, a microgrid system that allowed them to look at which houses were using the most energy and how they could respond and help those families really improve the efficiency of their homes and focus on the homes that had the greatest challenges. And then these stoves that would capture some of the excess energy and actually heat the homes during the wintertime. So it was phenomenal yesterday to be at Mayor Berkowitz's house and bump into one of the women who's been working on that project over the years and hear that it has been successful. And now neighboring villages have the stoves in their houses as well and have had an 80% reduction in the amount of diesel they're using. So that was an incredible aha moment for me to see this microgrid technology in action and see really how a community was able to respond far beyond anything that we're seeing in the lower 48 and inform us of what we're going to need to do. Now, it was also a lasting trip because I was told had I gotten stuck there, I would have had to sleep in the jail and or the school because there was no other place for me to be. And it was really important for me to see firsthand the challenges of the communities in Alaska because it is very different than what we talk about in the lower 48. It's not surprising that these kinds of pragmatic solutions are being developed and implemented locally. Some of the most productive conversations about climate change are happening at the local level. President Obama has made it a priority to support communities working to become more resilient to climate change and lift up solutions that work. He understands that folks on the front lines are going to have the best ideas about how best to prepare. They don't come out of Washington. They come from leadership here. That was the idea behind the task force of governors, mayors, tribal and territorial leaders that worked to translate their firsthand experience dealing with impacts like storms, flooding, and drought into concrete actions the federal government can take to support communities. Their recommendations to the president were released last year, and their message was clear, although we're still translating some of it, Mayor Joule. We have to make our communities stronger and better prepared for what's to come. We have to build and plan not for the last storm, but for the next one. And one of those leaders of the task force, as I mentioned, Mayor Reggie Joule is here from the Northwest Arctic Borough, and I'm sure he will share with you some of the other recommendations that were made. We have been extremely fortunate to have him share his voice as we have, and we look forward, as we have with Mayor Berkowitz, and we look forward to our partnership in the future. One thing is very clear. We all have a critical role to play in supporting solutions to promote climate preparedness, and we're not going to be able to do this alone. Earlier this year, the president made clear his commitment to focus on these challenges by issuing an executive order to address the need to prepare the nation for a changing Arctic, in establishing an Arctic Executive Steering Committee to enhance coordination of federal Arctic policies across the agencies, the White House and the state and local and Alaska Native tribal governments. As you will hear on this panel, the steering committee has been focusing on some of the major impacts to Alaskan communities, like coastal erosion. But the main focus here is to have one body that looks at all the challenges and all the different federal entities and what they're doing here in Alaska, and try and make sure that, as we said in that strategy in the beginning, we're having the intended outcome and it's having multiple benefits. We know the risks and impacts of climate change are not equally shared. This was very evident last week when the president traveled to New Orleans to see a community that's recovering after 10 years since Hurricane Katrina hit. Recently, we announced the New Orleans and Anchorage were selected as two of 10 Resilience AmeriCorps cities in partnership with federal agencies, the Rockefeller Foundation, and Cities of Service. The pilot program will bring AmeriCorps VISTA members into neighborhoods with both high environmental risk and high poverty rates to roll out initiatives that increase community resilience. These are the type of strategies where we will be working with folks on the ground to get the best results and really have the greatest impacts as we face this challenge together. So thank you so much for having me today, and I really look forward to the conversation.
Thank you very much, Christy. I had the opportunity to drive out to Portage Glacier yesterday with Christy and with Kathy Sullivan and a few others, and I know how personally committed she is to making a difference, and I want to thank you very much for the way in which you are reaching out to states, communities, and other countries to be a good partner. Our first panelist is Mayor Reggie Joule. He has been introduced already to you, but just as a reminder, in addition to being the mayor of the borough, he was in the legislature for what, 18 years? And while he was there, he led the legislature's effort to really concentrate on the Arctic. He was one of the co-chairs of the Northern Waters Task Force. And that was really kind of the first time that the Alaska legislature stepped forward and said, you know, we need an Arctic policy. And then that led into the Alaska Arctic Policy Commission. In addition to all of that and the many other ways in which he has served his community, his region, and his state, he has served the nation on this climate preparedness and resilience task force. So, Reggie, tell us about that experience and tell us about your region. Please help me welcome Reggie.
And what do I do? Technologically, I'm a...
Technologically, you're...
challenged.
Right here?
Okay.
And then go. That's the little green button.
Green button. Color I do know. Good morning. Those experiences, well, I can tell you this kind of in a nutshell. Throughout the years that I served in the legislature and in my time as a mayor, it's been, while it's been a challenging job, it's been kind of easy to keep things in perspective because those are not simply constituents. They're my family. They're my friends. This is very personal. That's the experience. In a nutshell. We'll give you some quick snapshots here. We're going to talk a little bit about the Northwest Arctic Borough or climate change. Our mission there in the borough. You know the trouble with bifocals? If you're not just looking at things just right, it's a challenge. I almost said it was a pain, but I won't go there. So our borough was established as a home rule borough in 1987. We have 11 communities. And we range in population from about 100 to 3,500. We have 38,000 square miles, just a tiny piece of real estate, and we're not even the largest borough in the state. Our relatives to the north carry that distinction. We have about 7,800 residents, and of that population, about 84% of that are Inupiaq, indigenous people. Our population is quite young, 41, almost 42% are under the age of 20, and our cost of living is very high. Subsistence has always been in most arenas are top priority, and when we don't list it, we hear about it from the people that we represent, whether it's gathering, hunting, fishing. And subsistence doesn't even mean all of those things. It's the essence of a life way of who we are that goes much beyond simply pulling a trigger. Oops. Half of our calories come from our foods. Our resources remain central to our nutritional, but economics, cultural, and our traditions of all of our communities. Climate change is changing habitat, migration routes, and the chemistry in our oceans, which impacts the very resources that we rely upon. Increasing resource development in our area, both on land and sea. You know, whether if you're in the oil fields, your exploration seasons get shorter. It's impacting that from climate change. And some of the issues that we're talking about when you have things like challenges like melting permafrost, concerns about health of animals. You know, there's some examples that are going on right now. It was just referred to this morning. The hollowouts of walrus because of the lack of ice. Warmer rivers, increasing occurrences of fungal diseases and raising some issues for our fish. For 2 years now, you know, with a low water level and different kinds of new plants are growing even more, when there gets to be a lot of fish and they have bottlenecks in those really shallow spots, they run out of oxygen. and perish as a result of that. And we've seen that for the last couple of years. Our Western Arctic caribou herd, the Tushikbuk herd, are being we're seeing reductions in those. Climate and erosion, this is something that several of our communities across the state, and certainly one of our communities in our borough, has been challenged with. But there's a picture there of Kotzebue, and I put that at the bottom because there are some things that can be done for mitigation in dealing with erosion. So, you know, if you have the opportunity to be a little proactive, which currently doesn't seem to be the case because we seem to be more reactive than proactive. But when you're proactive, this is what can happen, the bottom picture. When you're reactive, it's the above pictures is where we get put. A new report from U.S. Geological Survey found that shorelines along Alaska's northern coast has eroded at some of the fastest rates in the nation, putting local communities, oil fields, and coastal habitat at risk. We know that. But sometimes it's better to hear it again, because at some point we might get it. A 1,000-mile coastline from Canada border to east to Icy Cape, the West has lost ground at an average weight of 4.6 feet a year. You know, I'm 5 feet tall. Actually, no, I'm taller than that. I used to be a lot taller than that when I was younger and an athlete, but because of climate change, here's what's left. I'm a nervous wreck up here, you guys, and I need to just kind of settle down, and I thought that might help a little bit. But even at 5'4", that's about my shoulders, right? That's how much ground we're losing. That's to give you an eyeball deal. And so we have all of these challenges. We know that this impacts a lot of our communities. And I mentioned some of those communities. And they're not all on the coastal. Our river communities are also being impacted by erosion. All of our communities, all 11 of our communities, have these challenges, and it's just something that we can't say over and over again. The challenge for us is trying to find an entity with the capacity, as we plan for things, who can help share the lead for getting decisions made. And in the community of Kivalina, you know, it's not like you can drive away from a problem. The only way in and out is by air. The changes, the actions need to happen soon, because the members of those communities, Kivalina and others, really don't have the luxury of time. I want to talk a little bit, just briefly, because I've got 2 minutes. And Kivalina, in its current place, as you see there on that little barrier island, is looking to move. And whoops, I backed up. Back up. I'm just getting really, all right, it doesn't seem to be here. But there's a place 8 miles away that has some elevation. And this is the place that the community is looking to move towards. But roads have to get built. And in addition to that, to get people to safety, but a community has to be relocated. And this is the kind of challenge that a community like Kivalina is faced with. So with that, I'm going to wrap things up, because there's some folks here that also have a message. But I want to leave kind of a final remark, if you will. And that is, it's not like this is a new challenge, people. This is nothing new for our communities. this challenge has been there for a while. It's been there for years, actually. The problem is, and the challenge is this, we're very few people in those communities, and the cost of doing something about them is very high. And we often end up in a place when cost-benefit analysis get done, it comes with somebody paying that price. We're at the point where we need to take action, and this is about people's health and life safety. And it's just that simple. So I appreciate the time here, and we'll be available, hopefully, if you can, to answer some questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Reggie. You know, it seems very personal to us, particularly for those of us who live in Alaska and have been to some of these communities, but it's important for us to remember that it's not only happening in Alaska and not only happening in the Arctic. And our next panelist is going to remind us of that. Robin Bronen, who's the Executive Director of the Alaska Immigration Justice Project, has worked with the UN High Commission for Refugees on climate change issues. There are many people in many places that are facing a very similar dilemma, to stay or to go. And if to stay, what can be done about it? And if to go, where to go? And this will be an increasing challenge in this world. So without further ado, please help me welcome Robin.
Technology is challenging.
Why am I doing this?
That's me.
I think that's you. Okay.
It is.
All right, terrific. Here we go. They said be a moderator. They did not say work the computer. Okay.
Okay, and then it's F5, 2, and 4? Yeah. Okay. Cool. So I want to thank, Joule Clement in particular for inviting me to be on this panel. It is quite an honor. And honestly, I feel the weight of responsibility because this issue is one that I am deeply passionate about. And so as I'm speaking, I want you to think about three things. One, this is an environmental and human rights issue. And the reason why I say that is because right now, those people who are the most vulnerable and have the least resources are being impacted. This is a human rights issue because we have to make sure when the places where people live and maintain livelihoods need to leave those places, that their human rights are protected. As Fran mentioned, this is not just an issue for Alaska. It's happening here most profoundly. But guaranteed, with the information that we just heard this morning, this will be an issue that is going to affect millions of people in the world. And the third thing that I would say is urgent. You've heard that a number of times today, but urgent because we do not have the governance tools to deal with this issue at this time. I work as a human rights attorney. I got my PhD in 2012 on this issue. And as you can hear from the tone of my voice, I am desperately concerned that we act now. So what makes this so different? And I've worked as an immigration attorney, so have that area of expertise to add to this conversation. And what makes this so different is the land on which people live and maintain livelihoods is going to disappear. There is no going back. Two, I mentioned the governance tools. Governments normally are not involved in orchestrating the internal movement of their populations, and certainly not millions of people, and certainly not communities. And third, the human rights protections, how it is that in the face of what we are talking about in regard to sea level rise in particular, how are we going to make sure that the social and cultural heritage of people and those kinship ties are protected in the face of loss of land? So I learned really everything that I'm about to talk about from the incredible work of the Nutak Traditional Council and the Nutak Planning Group. And they, along with the communities of Kivalina and Shishmaref, provide models of what we need to get into place. And so I highlight the Nutak Traditional Council because that's the community that I've worked most closely with. And so they've been documenting their erosion since 1983. They've been raising the awareness of state and federal government officials about the need to relocate since the 1990s. The Traditional Council took the active step along, and again, I mentioned Kivalina and Shishmaref because they already did, they also did this. They identified potential relocation sites. They had their community members vote on where they wanted to relocate to. And in the case of Nutak, Nutak actually hired a lobbyist who lobbied Congress for 8 years to get land title to their chosen relocation site, which is 9 miles across the Ninglick River. So despite taking all of that action, Nutak has still not relocated. And when I started my PhD in 2007, and I was attending one of the many intergovernmental meetings of the Nutak Planning Group, they said Nutak would be relocated by 2012 at the latest, because it was understood that the largest building in their community would disappear by 2017. And they still have not relocated. And the primary reason is because we do not have a relocation institutional framework, not only in the United States, but nowhere in the world. And I'm just going to highlight two of the reasons why this is so critical. First, we need to figure out, prior to there being an extreme weather event that displaces people, when people, as Reggie was talking about, can proactively protect their heritage and their community and relocate prior to that displacement. We have no governance mechanisms in place at this time to figure out at what point in time does a community relocate. The second is there's no statutory mandate or funding to make a relocation happen. And in the United States, the barriers include our disaster relief and hazard mitigation legislation, because one, that legislation does not include sea level rise or erosion as precipitating events that can release funding. And two, the funding is primarily dedicated to repairing and rebuilding in the place of the disaster. So what my research has focused on is trying to conceive of what a new relocation institutional framework could look like. And this is my conception of an adaptive governance framework based in human rights protections, where you always start with protection in place, because while I'm advocating for a relocation institutional framework, that is the last resort. So we need to use all the technologies possible to protect people where they are. Then we need to figure out, from the community level to government level, what those relocation indicators are, the imminent danger to community, repeated extreme weather events, the impact on public health, and transfer funding that's gone to protecting a community in place to making a relocation possible. We were, the Alaska Immigration Justice Project, where I currently work, we just received funding from NOAA to actually start implementing and conceiving of what this relocation institutional framework could look like. And one of the critical pieces to think about community-based adaptation is we need to be giving the tools to communities of how to monitor and assess the environmental change going on, along with government actors who have that technical expertise, so that adaptation strategies are ongoing, right? We know that climate change is not static, and adaptation cannot be static. And the only way that we can ensure for resilience is if communities are given the tools to monitor and assess the environmental change that is going on, and engaging with government actors so that they can protect their communities in the way that they think best. And you've heard of why the Arctic matters. And the reason why I'm so passionate about this is because, so there's a NASA photo of Greenland in 2012 when 97% of the ice sheet was thawing. And of course, that was the same year when we had record lows of Arctic sea ice extent recorded earlier than previously recorded. And that's a map of the United States. And the orange are all the places in the United States that will be affected by sea level rise. Between New Jersey and Florida, 1,000 kilometers, 600 square miles will be inundated with 3 meters of sea level rise. And the thing to remember is sea level rise is not going to be a linear experience, meaning 1 inch this year and 1 inch next year. It could be 12 inches next year and exponentially more in the years to come. And if you look at the climate science, they're still grappling with how much sea level rise is projected to occur by the end of the century, and it could be as much as 3 feet. So finally, in moving this issue forward, I've had the honor of going to the South Pacific. And with two people from the Nutak Traditional Council, we went to the Carteret Islands in Papua New Guinea, because the Carteret Islanders are also looking at the relocation of their entire community. And we're hoping to bring back the Carteret Islanders to Alaska next year, along with the governments and communities of Fiji and the Solomon Islands, to really look at the recommendations we can make to the world of how relocations can occur and protect the human rights of all the people who are going to be forced to relocate because of climate change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robin. And I just want to say that the reference that Robin made to the importance of empowering people to be able to keep track of the change that is happening in their communities and working in partnership with the scientists is a topic that we're going to talk about this afternoon in the observing section. These things are very tied together because we need the information, we need to have the understanding, and that needs to be at the local, state, federal, and international level. It's a call out to action. Our next panelist is someone that you all know very well, Craig Fleener. Craig Fleener was appointed by Governor Walker as his Arctic policy advisor last year. But he brings to this job such an amazing and wonderful combination, not only because of his 28 years in the military and because he used to run the subsistence division for fish and game, because he has been a tribal leader, because he is Gwich'in, because he has previously been a permanent participant at the Arctic Council table. He could bring all of those things to this position and help the governor and his cabinet and the state exercise leadership in this important area. Please help me welcome Craig.
Well, thank you very much. And what I'm going to do is to give a brief overview of the impacts of erosion on Alaska communities and some of the resilience and adaptation steps that we are taking to resolve or learn to live with these issues here in Alaska. And I'm going to speak rather quickly because I have a lot of information in a very short time. In 2008, the Climate Change Impact Mitigation Program began to provide funding and technical assistance to communities imminently threatened by erosion. A total of $1.6 million was appropriated by the state legislature. The program enables hazard impact assessments, community resilience planning, and mitigation for protection against storms and flood events, post-disaster reconstruction, and for studies and investigation to identify other climate change-related impacts that threaten lives, property, and the economy. In 2008, $50,000 in mini-grants for hazard impact assessment were awarded to the communities of Nelson Lagoon, Quinnahock, Nightmute, and Elam. The assessments analyzed hazard threats and future impacts to the community and recommended solutions to mitigate the impacts of these natural hazards. In the same year, two community planning grants at $150,000 each were awarded to Atmatluak and Kipnuk for community resilience planning due to coastal and riverine erosion. Erosion-threatened communities have been struggling with these threats for quite some time. In 1994, Kivalina began relocation planning and has continued to progress plans, development, and on-the-ground action since. In 2006 and 2007, after severe storm events, Governor Frank Murkowski issued two administrative orders directing state agencies to coordinate with each other, federal agencies, and other entities to plan for mitigation, adaptation, and relocation. In 2010, the state assisted the community in developing consensus on mitigation options for relocation for some or all of the village and options for future community sites. Through the Alaska Community Coastal Protection Project, three communities, Kivalina, Shaktulik, and Shishmaref, are working with interagency groups to develop comprehensive resilience strategies. These plans are designed to cover a 10 to 20 year span for incremental actions and strategies and will serve to build local capacity for disaster response and recovery, and also to look forward for planning and implementing relocation projects and developing blueprints for community resilience and community capacity building. From 2008 to 2013, the state issued seven storm and flood-related disaster declarations, providing funding for reconstruction, infrastructure needs, and some assistance to individuals for private property damage, totaling up to about 130 projects and nearly $90 million. In 2015, disasters were declared for flooding on the Dalton and Glen highways and for two large wildfires that threatened residential areas on the Kenai Peninsula. On Wednesday, just 5 days ago, the United States issued its first winter storm warning. In addition to snow and beating wind, came flooding across the Arctic. Though there was no significant damage, as fall and winter approach, so does the increase in storm surges and the coastal erosion that will follow. The Department of Military and Veterans Affairs, Homeland Security, and Emergency Management Division helps prepare and train Alaskans for emergency response, community evacuation, and recovery operations for disasters like coastal storm surge and river floods. They provide outreach, training, and the opportunity to exercise what's been learned and to capitalize on those best practices. The DMVA exercises and exercising and training are tailored to improve individual, organizational, and community-wide performance during environmental disasters like storm surges on the coastline or during river floods in the spring throughout the state. The U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development initiated the National Disaster Resilience Competition for communities to design and implement residential and communal infrastructure protection from environmental disasters, particularly for designated areas of the state with disaster declarations between 2011 and 13. Four state agencies, the Military and Veterans Affairs, Commerce, Environmental Conservation, and Alaska Housing Finance Corporation, are developing the state of Alaska's application to HUD for innovative resilience projects that will increase long-term resilience in imperiled communities. And now we'll talk a little bit about some of the specific issues in some communities. The state of Alaska is most involved with the relocation, planning, and undergoing projects for the Nutak Village Council. This village is surrounded on three sides by river and coastline. Millions of dollars have been spent over 30 years on shoreline and erosion mitigation. Current studies indicate that at least half of the village will constantly be inundated by water over the next 15 years. To date, upwards of $27 million have been spent by the state and the federal government on background studies, environmental assessments for relocation planning and construction projects. Luckily, the residents in this community have good foresight and began relocation planning some time ago, and those efforts continue to this day in tandem with the state and other agencies. Kivalina, which I just recently visited for the first time, is located on an island. It's historically been protected, but with permafrost melting and the reduction in ice coverage during storm season, the island is being battered and increasingly eaten away by coastal erosion. A project to relocate the community with only minimal housing and infrastructure is estimated to cost more than $123 million. In Kivalina alone, it is estimated that storm damage over the next 20 years will cost hundreds of millions of dollars for repair and reconstruction. Now multiply that times 30 or 40 or 50 or 60, however many communities are going to be at risk over the short term, the ones that are in imminent danger of their community disappearing into the ocean or into the river. But it isn't just about the cost in dollars. Think long and hard about the impact of loss of life, loss of property, and a devastated community. And add that to the concept of living in fear every single time a storm brews, wondering if you'll have a community tomorrow. That's what these folks are living with every single day. Shaktulik is losing approximately 38,300 square feet of land per year to the sea. There are 14 outbuildings and 18 residences threatened by coastal erosion. Total damages to these structures are estimated to cost upwards of $10 million to repair. Shaktulik and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers were on their way to an agreement under Section 117 of the Energy and Water Development Act that empowered the Corps to address erosion, ice, and glacial damage, and the relocation of communities at 100% federal cost if specific criteria were met. Unfortunately, Section 117 was repealed in 2009, leaving communities like Shaktulik with few options. Shishmaref is working on a relocation coalition with over 40 state, federal, and tribal private nonprofit entities. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers estimates the cost of community relocation at more than $180 million. Several years ago, the community selected the Tin Creek site as the best option for relocation, but it has since been ruled out due to ice lenses that would decrease building foundation integrity. Shishmaref is conducting a relocation site feasibility to identify a nearby site. Now I'll move on a little bit to what the state and other agencies have been working on. In 2009, the Climate Change Subcabinet Immediate Action Working Group penned policies that establish a statewide system to document, assess, and analyze current and planned infrastructure for better investment and to prevent threat to life. Also to direct state agencies to establish interagency collaboration, to use comprehensive, integrated planning and viable future-oriented solutions with funding that allows for sustainability, and to lead a coordinating effort and to develop a comprehensive statewide data collection and evaluation system that provides information for communities and businesses. The Denali Commission, of course, is a tremendous federal and state tribal-local partnership introduced by Congress in 1998. As an independent federal agency designed to provide critical utilities, infrastructure, and economic support throughout Alaska. With the creation of the Denali Commission, Congress acknowledged the need for increased interagency cooperation and focus on Alaska's remote communities. There is a vision that the Commission can act as a full state, federal, tribal, local community partnership with a specific focus on climate adaptation and relocation planning, and we look forward to that as we move forward. I'm not there at questions yet. I think I went one too far. The Walker administration is fully supportive of the Denali Commission and any ongoing future efforts that the commission might take to help threatened communities and vulnerable communities with relocation planning and projects. We look for a strong partnership. Two relocation plans in particular from 2007 were funded by the commission. That's the Shaktulik Evacuation Road Preliminary Engineering Plan and the Kivalina Evacuation Road Plan. In wider terms, the Commission has funded 18 community planning projects at $500,000 to better address zoning, economic, and infrastructure needs. But it's important for state and federal agencies to fund resiliency programs. However, even more critical to the communities around Alaska that are experiencing these problems is our supporting and enabling community-driven adaptation that comes from them, serves their needs, and incorporates their cultures for the projects that we're going to be supporting. So thank you very much.
Our final panelist this morning is Tommy Beaudreau. Tommy Beaudreau is the Chief of Staff to Secretary Sally Joule, and he will have the opportunity to make this presentation in front of his boss. Secretary Sally Joule is with us this morning, and I very much appreciate the fact that you are taking the time to hear firsthand the complexity of this problem. And for Tommy, I just want to say, I think I first met you when you were Assistant Secretary for Land and Minerals, when he had part of the responsibility of helping to unwind the Minerals Management Service, MMS, and splitting it into its various parts that exist today. I was serving on the Deepwater Horizon Oil Spill Commission, and we watched as Department of Interior made a huge shift in creating BSEE and BOEM. And then he went on to head BOEM. You were the director of BOEM for a number of years during that transition and did a great job. And now I know you're doing a great job for Sally. So we'd love to hear from you, because we know that the Department of Interior is a major land manager in the state of Alaska and needs to be and continues to be a good partner with all of us. Thank you. Tommy.
Thanks, Fran. Thanks very much, Fran. And Mayor Joule, I'm a little nervous too, because my boss is here, and she's also sitting next to one of my former classmates who's now president of Bristol Bay Native Corporation. And so all I can say about that is I've matured a lot since high school, and not to believe everything you hear. So let me take a moment to amplify a little bit on some of what you heard earlier today in the plenary and also today about the real threat that a number of Alaskan communities, Arctic communities, coastal communities are facing right now. And to emphasize, as you've heard already, the real humanitarian dimension to this and the urgency around it. These communities, especially Arctic Ocean coastal communities, are facing a sort of double whammy threat as a result of climate change. You have, with receding sea ice, intensification of storms and intensification of both weather systems and also wave action that is pounding these communities in a way that's never been seen before. And you combine that with permafrost melt, and literally the ground is being washed out from under them, again, in a completely unprecedented way. Last February, I traveled with Secretary Joule to one of these communities that we've heard a little bit about, Kivalina, and went to Kivalina. And again, it's situated on a barrier island, and it's been pounded by these storms, including not too long ago, a particularly devastating one. And while we were gathered together in the gymnasium of the small school in Kivalina, they had playing in the background on continuous loop video footage of the desperation folks were facing as they filled sandbags and tried to do everything they could to resist the onslaught from the sea that was coming in the middle of this storm. We couldn't have gotten a more warm and gracious welcome, but at the same time, we heard very harrowing stories from the community about the fears they have and about the worries they have for their community. One woman in particular told the secretary about the nightmares she has about and recurring dreams she has of her family and grandchildren being washed out into the sea. And that left an enormous impression on me, and on, I know, the secretary as well. Fortunately, coming out of that, we had just a couple days later the very first convening session of the Arctic Executive Steering Committee. Part of the mission of that committee is to try to bring a much better coordinated federal effort around assisting the state and these communities with the problem of coastal erosion and the threats of climate change. As you heard, you may have heard the president in his radio address in advance of this trip, and you've heard from Mayor Joule and from Robin and Craig as well, this truly does have a humanitarian dimension to it. As the president said, if in the lower 48, we could tell the American people today that there are dozens of communities that are literally being threatened with being wiped off the map. You can imagine the mobilization that would happen under those circumstances. And we need to bring the same sort of attention and urgency to this problem that's facing hundreds of people in dozens of communities in Alaska right now. As Craig and others have talked about, these communities aren't just standing by, however. There have been years of effort to begin thinking about and trying to address these problems. Kivalina, Shishmaref, Shaktulik, Newtok, others have already formed village planning groups that are developing local strategic management plans to think about hard issues like immediate emergency response, as well as the very difficult, I mean, we sort of have thrown it out there, but this is an incredibly difficult proposition to even contemplate around relocation and what that means. But a number of communities are already stepping up and trying to think through these issues for themselves as well as the specific threats. I'm here to talk a little bit about the federal government's role in connection with all of that. The one thing I want to make clear right up front is this cannot be an issue that gets defined or solved for or planned for strictly out of Washington, D.C. And that's why what we're talking about today and what this administration hopes to see come together as we move forward is really coordinating with and empowering the villages and the states to work better with the federal government, for the federal government to take ownership of that issue and establish a structure that allows for problem solving around this, planning around it, and resources and technical assistance to come to bear. So our job, as we see it right now, is essentially twofold. And this was, I thought, teed up extremely well by Robin. One of the things that is missing and that we're trying to correct is establishing a structure to better support local communities in the state to tackle this problem and to help support state-led and local community-led efforts without dictating outcomes. You know, some of you are familiar with the term, we're from the federal government and we're here to help. That is obviously met with a lot of chuckles for reasons we all know. That's what we want to avoid, though. We want to avoid having some sort of heavy-handed but well-meaning effort from Washington, D.C. That ends up dictating outcomes, dictating decisions to the people who are actually affected by it and have to live with those decisions. And so the second component that is needed, especially at this moment in time, is a structure and the creativity necessary to break through all of the various bureaucratic silos that exist across the federal government. There are a number of agencies in the federal government, the Interior Department, HUD, HHS, the Army Corps, just to name a few, who have technical expertise, have resources, have skill sets that really can and should be brought to bear on helping solve these issues over the long term. And some of that has happened, but it's happening in sort of discrete and, I'm sorry to say, relatively uncoordinated ways right now. And we need to have a body and a structure that not only helps break through those silos, but can apply some creative thinking to solve around some of the bureaucratic and legal problems that are stymieing this effort now. Robin mentioned changes in authorities and roadblocks like that. Part of what we envision through this structure is the ability not only to help with technical assistance on applying for grants and putting people in touch with the right folks and making sure there's good communication, as important as all of that is, but part of what needs to happen too is a brain-on exercise thinking creatively about new ways to approach this problem, new authorities that may be necessary, and real partnership, even on potential legislative solutions, to give the agencies and the communities a way to respond in a way that makes sense to this crisis. It breaks my heart a little bit when we talk to folks and they say, well, you know, we talked to FEMA, but, you know, sort of without having already been inundated by a catastrophic storm, they're not sure what they can do for us. And so it's issues like that that there's got to be a common sense solution for. There's got to be a way to deal with it. Part of what you'll hear from us, and Craig, I think, alluded to this a little bit, is there are some ready-made structures and organizations out there that we can devote to this effort, and the Denali Commission is one of them. The Denali Commission is ready-made for partnership with this type of effort. It represents Alaska Natives, it has representation from the state, and it has representation from the federal government, the three main parties necessary to bring an entire whole-of-government thoughtful approach to these problems. And so I think what you'll hear in the coming days is a lot more about the structure, ways we can make use of it, and the president's very strong commitment to these coastal communities and the urgency that is necessary to bring to bear on this to help solve these problems. So thanks very much, and look forward to answering any questions.
So believe it or not, we have done what I was hoping for, save time for questions. And there is a microphone at the back of the room. So I am happy to have people, actually, is there also a roving mic? There's also a roving mic. Great, so you don't have to walk all the way to the back of the room. So while someone is deciding that they are ready to raise their hand and ask a question, I just want to say two quick things. First of all, after listening to this panel this morning and Christy's opening remarks, I think it's very obvious that for all of us who really care about not only Alaska and the Arctic, but the people of the world, that it is, as Secretary Kerry said this morning, long past time for us to actually act, both at the local level in terms of adaptation and the challenge associated with resilience, but also at the global level to slow the rate of warming. Because the expanding pool of communities, families, and people whose lives are on the line is something that we just can't ignore anymore. So I would just urge people who have participated today and who have heard these panelists to take that message to your friends and to your colleagues and your coworkers, and perhaps even the people that you talk to who really aren't sure yet that this is a serious problem. The second point that I want to make before we take a question is about agency action. There have been a couple of references already this morning to the executive order that the president signed in January of this year that created the steering committee for the Arctic. I think it's really important to put that very briefly in context. In 2013, President Obama signed the National Arctic Strategy for the United States, a first. In 2014, the president adopted the implementation plan to make that National Arctic Strategy a reality. And then in January of 2015, he created the steering committee to oversee that process. And I am pleased to be able to serve on that steering committee as an Alaskan. My point is this: these problems, these issues, these concerns, these challenges and opportunities have been simmering for a long time. But this administration has stepped up to focus on the Arctic in a way that previously just didn't happen at the level of the President, the Secretary of State, the Secretary of Interior, and the rest of the team that is reflected in the work product of that steering committee. So not to say that there isn't a lot of work to be done, and I'm not trying to say that the problems have been solved. I am trying to say that the level of attention and action and agency involvement is much different than it has been in the past. And it calls out for partnerships with the state of Alaska, with the international community, like what is happening today, as well as with people on the ground in communities, tribes, corporations, businesses, and local leaders. So when we sometimes get discouraged, I just want to remind people that there's a lot that's been moving in a very positive direction, and we need to build on that. Okay, so who has the microphone for a question? Yes, please introduce yourself.
Sure, Tom Wagner from NASA, but I'm also one of the worker bees on the White House committees for the IARPIC and things. Hey, question I think mostly for Dr. Bronen and Mayor Joule. Great talks, by the way. What other kinds of scientific information would you like, you know, about observations, processes, and things, and how would you like to get it? In Washington, we kind of spend a lot of time talking about, you know, we produce all these great new satellite images and models and stuff, but we try to work out ways to kind of get it down to people that can actually use it. So I would just love to hear what you're using or not using and what you'd be interested in.
Thank you. I don't know if the mic's on.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that question. So the information that you would have at a global or regional level is critically important, but it needs to be synchronized with locally captured data. And so we haven't started our project yet, but the things that would be really, I think, of urgent need are projections in regard to sea level rise and decreased Arctic sea ice extent, and other things that will be affecting the land on which people live, to get that bigger perspective than locally captured data.
The only thing I would add to that is the Army Corps of Engineers is actively engaged in these processes. The challenge for the community with that engagement is that the requirement of the communities to come up with a matching fund. And the communities, whether it's a single community like Nutak or Kivalina or Shishmaref, whether they can come up with those matching funds or even a borough agency can come up with those matching funds, becomes quite a challenge if you're low on resources anyway. So, you know, understanding some of that so you can get some forward, not only get the forward momentum, but to keep the momentum going so you're not stopping and starting through the whole process.
And I would just add, we welcome your participation in our project because it just started and we are developing a new model. And I want to acknowledge Michael Brubaker from the Alaska Native Tribal Health Consortium, who is part of our one of our partners. So we welcome your participation in our project.
And I might just note that that is the topic of the observing discussion this afternoon, actually, at what kind of scale is the information being accumulated and documented and shared, and how can that kind of go at both the local level and the global level in a way that really helps people make good decisions. Next question.
Good morning. I'm Traditional Chief Gary Harrison from Chickaloon Village, and I've noticed that there's a lot of talk on the coast and what's happening with the coastal villages, and I just want to remind people that there's a lot of things happening on the inland as well. And people who live off of salmon might realize that there's things happening on land that are affecting the fish that travel back and forth between the oceans. There's a lot of glaciers up in the high mountains. Their trails are changing. I took a couple of ladies from France who were doing a documentary on permafrost thawing, and I took them up to a valley, which you can almost see from here, and showed them some of the permafrost that's melting the whole hillsides, whole valleys in this mountain range here, that the permafrost is melting and they're sliding, which is creating a lot of problems for not only the animals but the people who go there. And not only that, but the change in the food that like the caribou and stuff are eating, the change in the habitat that's happening, it's happening a lot rapider than a lot of people understand. And I haven't noticed that there's a lot of studies on those type of things, whereas there's a lot more going on the coastal erosion. So I'm wondering if there's going to be more studies and more things done on the land as well as what's happening on the ocean and in the coast.
Craig, Fleener, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, I'm glad you picked me. I had something to say. I mean, the answer has to be yes. I think we need to take a full spectrum look at the entire state. And if I could have it exactly my way, I don't know if I get it my way. So if anybody's listening, I'd like it my way. No, I think what we need to do is work very closely with the communities that are at risk across the state. And there are dozens and dozens of them, not only along the coast, but many along the river. My hometown of Fort Yukon, as you know, gets flooded often. And the other communities in the Yukon Flats where I come from also suffer from flood and disaster, loss of property. And it's tragic in those communities, so we have to work together. So I can't speak to a specific, I cannot give you an exact answer from the agencies because I haven't asked that exact question. But if it were to go my way, we would work directly with the communities that are at risk and work with them to establish a plan that's based on the community's needs, not based on what the state necessarily wants to do. Of course, we want to bring in state expertise, federal expertise, and other expertise to help us with whatever the solution is that the community wants. Sometimes a community may want to move, some communities may not, and they look towards engineering instead of the community moving. I would find it very, very difficult if I came from a community that knew that it was in the same exact place for 8,000 years, and now all of a sudden I've got to move 9 miles away or 10 or 20 or 40 miles away to some place that I wasn't tied to. That would be very difficult for me. So we want to make sure that we're culturally sensitive and that those plans come directly from the communities with as much agency support as we can provide.
I might note just very briefly, there are many people in this room from the University of Alaska Fairbanks and the University of Alaska Anchorage who could probably talk to you quite a bit about the amount of work that is also being done inland. We haven't talked a lot about it today, but there is a rich resource at both universities as well as with Fish and Wildlife, National Park Service, and others. I know that they are doing a lot of work, but in the interest of time, I won't call on them to answer that question. Is there another question for the panel?
Yes, Fran. I'd just like a shout out to our federal partners and add on to what you said is over the last couple of years, the Alaska Arctic Policy Commission has worked with Brendan Kelly, Eric Cooper, recently Deborah Orr, and now Mark Brzezinski, which we were able to meet yesterday over the phone, and I met him last night. I would just have to say that we're very encouraged by this this evolution of the state of Alaska working with its federal partners. And you've kept saying that, and it was coming, because at first we had to kick the doors in. But I just want to say that that today the legislature feels very confident in this new cooperation.
Thank you, and I might note that Mark Brzezinski is in the room. If you want to just stand up, Mark. Mark is the former U.S. ambassador to Sweden, and he was named a couple weeks ago as the chief person to make sure that the steering committee's work gets done. I'm not sure if your title is executive director or...
It's executive director, okay. But really the mission is to achieve what Mayor Joule and what Craig alluded to, and that's coordinating at the state and local level with the people of Alaska. And I want to ask Craig Fleener and Mayor Joule to please give me and the committee some advice. Because one of the things that we've been entrusted with as a mission by President Obama is to coordinate with you, the people of Alaska, regarding what is happening here and what the priorities of the U.S. government should be. This is a vast state with many different voices. Can you provide some logistical advice? I'm doing all I can to get around the state this visit, the next visit, and the one after that. But I want to be able to kind of crystallize an approach to develop a unity of purpose with you at the state and local level to achieve the results that you talked about.
I think we have time for one more question, and whoever gets the mic gets to ask the question, and then we will unfortunately have to break.
Thank you. Eugene Asiksik from Shaktulik. Not really a question, just some comments that we had to deal with at Shaktulik. First, we lived up the river, and the government came along and wanted to educate us. They built a school on the beach. So we had to move in 1970. And currently, we're listed again as one of the five villages of imminent danger of erosion. I've heard comments of Denali Commission. Because we said we wanted to relocate, Denali Commission pulled our clinic. They pulled our fuel tank storage tanks and our AVAC power building. So basically everything that's in Shaktulik has been there from the old village that we relocated from. And I hope that we could see some changes. There was no capital money, federal or state, being spent in Shaktulik. And we finally got Governor Parnell to do a $9.2 million remodel of our school. We followed with a $1.5 million multi-purpose building, and again with a $500,000 loader. And it states that we voted to stay and defend because we realized that we weren't getting any infrastructure in the community. When we were hit with storms, we either were bypassed or that they said it wasn't a loss. So we decided to build our own berm. We started with 60,000, banked that, and we got 120,000. Then we got some more private money of 500,000. Now that we had to deal with gravel and other issues, we got $9,000 military used trucks from Anchorage, got them to ship them to Shaktulik for $13,000, and we used our own local labor. But again, it's positive to hear, and I just wanted to make some comments that it will not work as easy if you want to relocate.
Thank you for sharing the Shaktulik experience, and I think it points out that there's no one answer to a very complicated problem that will really require not only a lot of good faith, innovation, honesty with each other about what is achievable and how we can pay for it, but also the kind of long-term vision that perhaps we haven't always had when we have tried to solve problems in Alaska. Like many of you, I've lived here for a long time, and I have seen a lot of programs come and go, and I've seen a lot of things done that were really done out of the goodness of the heart of whatever agency was trying to do it. But sometimes we create more problems by the solutions we choose. And I guess the law of unintended consequences has played out in some really profound and expensive ways in our state. Can we do better in the 21st century than we did in the 20th? That's my hope. And if we keep our eye on the ball, and that is that we have a long-term stewardship obligation to future generations as well as solving today's problems, then I think we can make progress. Please help me in thanking our panel. Thanks for being with us today. We're adjourned. Thank you all very much. Good job.